We all say we want to have a blessed life, but what does that really mean? Is it simply having a nice car, a big house, new clothes? What if a blessed life isn't what you think? What if it's more about what you give away than what you hold on to? What if it's more about the contents of your heart than the contents of your bank account? How do we really live the blessed life?
Okay, we're concluding our series on the blessed life, and that's today. And so I want to encourage you to go back to cornerstonecheshire.com as we look at what the Bible has to say about being blessed. You know, it's amazing because, you know, when you think about being blessed in our carnite mind and finite mind, we often think being blessed means whoever has the most toys wins. Right? Whoever has the biggest bank account, whoever has the largest family, whoever has the most things or the most accolades or reaches the pinnacle of social economic status, they're the ones that are blessed. They're the ones that are blessed. And otherwise, it's not really blessed. If you're famous, if you're seen as someone important, why is it that our media culture today, you know, at People Magazine and Lifestyles and movie stars, that they're like what we try to emulate. You know, back in the old time with the Greeks, they had the Greek mythology. It seems we have entertainment mythology, don't we? Isn't it amazing how we look at these people? We try to be like Angelina Jolie or or someone like that. I try to be like Arnold Schwarzenegger back in the 80s. I'm more like him now in the 2000s. But, you know, we try to be these people, and we're trying to match up. In fact, it's become like a culture where we all parade what we have. And we have a medium to do that. It's called social media. And even the highest office in the land, he tends to use it as well. You know, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and, you know, someone shows how they're going to the store shopping, so I'm going to do better. I'm going to the Christmas tree in New York City. So you put your picture there, and the person, I'm going to go to Paris. So we all try to outdo each other, and it just seems to me, and you do not agree, that it's all about that, and all the selfie photos, right? We try to get the, and by the way, I want to teach you a little secret about selfie photos, okay? When this is what, never take a selfie photo from the bottom up, okay? Because what happens is you look like you have a goblet. What you got to do is you got to go above like this, and you have to suck in a little bit to get the cheekbones to come out. And that's how you do it, okay? And that way you look like you lost a few pounds. People say, well, you look like you lost some weight and you look more healthy. Yeah, I have. But, you know, isn't it amazing, though, and we think a blessed life is being liked or having a promotion or something like that, and especially during the holiday season. Maybe you come to church and you see all these people together and you see couples in love and you see families happy and you come by yourself or you come with your spouse or you come and you recognize that it's a mirage, that it's a facade, that deep down you're lonely, you don't feel blessed. In fact, this relationship is so painful, you wish you could eject it from your life. And you come to church and it's painful to see other people. And you're like, if I could only get what I really wanted, if I could only get this, if I could only get that. And there's always this, we end up living on islands. I call them someday isles. Someday I'll do this. Someday I'll do that. We live in the islands instead of living in the here and now and letting God bless us. Truth is, God wants you to be blessed. He really, really does. It's his desire that your soul would prosper and that you would be blessed. But the blessing that God has for us is so much better than the blessing we try to emulate in the world. It's so much greater. And the thing of the matter is, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you know better in your spirit, man. Deep down, you know what it means to be blessed. But what happens is we convince ourselves that we almost brainwash our spirits in believing if we have all these things, then we'll be happy. And sometimes what we do is we take a religious spin on it and we wrap the worldly system around around spirituality that isn't true. And what happens, you're never happy. You never have enough. And then you start getting upset because other people are doing better and that are not believers. Let me tell you something. You will never be happy as a believer trying to get happy and fulfilled in this world. It's not going to work. Why? Because your spirit knows there's something so much better. And the secret to a blessed life is to be like Jesus Christ, to be like God, For God so loved, he gave. The secret of life is not what you take, but what you give. The secret of life is not extracting, but giving. Oh, come on, you're just saying, no, I'm telling you, the greatest people that have made the greatest contributions in society, real contributions, have been people that have given themselves. And there's nothing greater. And what happens is, listen, we've been talking about this. The whole purpose is we don't give to get. We give because God gives. And when we give blessed. It's a side benefit. You see, if you go after the blessing, you miss the blessing. If you go after God, you get God and the blessing. That's how it works. That's how it works. And so today we're going to conclude about asking the blessing of being generous. That God wants us to be generous. And the question is, am I generous? Because God is generous. He gave everything. He gave everything. Everything he had, he gave. It's an amazing thing. And so the Bible talks about that. And so what happens is this, selfishness is something that creates, puts a hole in the satisfaction bucket of your life. The meaning of life bucket in your life. Selfishness puts a gaping hole, and you have to fill the hole faster. Imagine you had a water bucket, and you have a hose, and you have a hole in it. The more selfish you get, the bigger the hole gets. You have to put the water on faster and faster and faster, and no matter how much you put into it, it never seems to fill. That's what selfishness does. And selfishness, remember this, selfishness has the same first letter as Satan. Satan's selfish. I will make myself like the Most High God. I will go higher than the highest point. He became selfish. And listen, when you and I become selfish, we take on the character of Satan. Selfishness does not think of somebody else, but thinks of itself. And some of us have become really, myself included at times, have become experts in dressing up selfishness with generosity. And that's the first thing. Now, what's so interesting is this. Generosity is like God. Starts with a G. So remember, selfishness is like equals Satan. Generosity equals God. So we're going to look today and see what the Bible says about being generous. And I want to encourage you today. I think this is one of the most important messages in this whole series because it's going to help you and I to remember what Christmas is all about. And so let's go forward here. We are born selfish, okay? You are born selfish. When a child is born, no matter what English, no matter what language they have, they learn to say the word mine. They can articulate it very, very well. Mine. Okay? Mine. Mine. You hear it, like mine. And one day you'll be in the house, and I understand it because I had little children, and I still understand it. And you're hearing, mine, 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 mine. You're like, ah, stop. And you hear it, and all of a sudden your nerves start going, and you're like, this got to stop this. It's almost like a fire alarm going off where it just begins to pierce your ears, and your ears are not even pierced. And so you run down, and you say, stop it and give it to him. But it's mine. I don't care, your little brother. It's your little brother's. I mean, you don't care about justice. You just want it to stop. It's called mine. We are born selfish. It takes no effort to be selfish. You don't need a PhD to go selfish. As I said in the past, all of us have postgraduate degrees in selfishness. It comes natural. You don't have to work on it. It's easy. We're born selfish, but we're born again generous. And what happens is this. When we're selfish, it actually damages and hurts our born-again spirit. It literally grieves the Spirit of God in us. And so what happens is the more you grab, the less you get. And God is gracious because if you're his, he doesn't want to have you waste your life. And so you might find yourself struggling more than other people, and you're wondering why. Could it be that we're grabbing onto being selfish? Now listen, I was just listening to a podcast last night. My wife and I listened to a lot of podcasts. A parenting podcast, and a lady was sharing, a doctor, a PhD, a former pediatrician was talking about, says, listen, it's normal for kids to be selfish. It's just how they grow up. It's their brain development. So I disagree with that woman. You know, we're born selfish. It's all about me. And so what happens is, when you and I are generous, you know what happens? We're feeding the Spirit of God in us. And the Spirit of God in us gets stronger and greater. And the Spirit of God will begin to beat up on the old nature. Whatever you feed leads you. So listen, born again is generous. Selfishness is the old nature. So we're going to look at a couple passages of Scripture today, about three passages of Scripture that demonstrate this quite clearly. And the first we're going to look at is the whole issue of how Jesus was born. You heard about the Magi, the wise men. I hate to shatter some of your little figurines that you have in your mantle, but the wise men, was there necessarily three? We don't know how many there were. And Frank, they didn't come to the babe. They didn't come to the manger. They came to a house later on. I guess what you should really, really do is go out and buy another nativity set and have step A, which show the stall and all that, and have step B happen in the house as a toddler. Because that's what happened. A couple of years later, the Magi from the east came, and they brought gifts to Jesus. And it's amazing what has happened through that and what we can learn from that. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod, okay, Herod was the king of the day, and behold, wise men from the east. And so as we study about it, we think of Magi, we think they're from the Far East, probably from Iraq or Iran area, and they were known to study the astrological calendar. They were known to look into the stars. Some even said, extra biblical stuff, not from the Bible, that some of these Magi predicted Alexander the Great when he was born. They say a great leader would be born at this time, and lo and behold, Alexander the Great was born. So, you know, this type of things, the Magi were known for that, that they would look into the sky. So are you saying, okay, am I giving you a pass to go get the horoscopes? No, I'm not. But the Bible says all creation proclaims the Lord Jesus Christ. God allows nature to coincide, to be the backup singers, if you will, of his song of redemption. And so what happened is these wise men didn't necessarily know what were going on, but they were going after God. They wanted to know God, and God spoke to them. Now, what I find so amazing, these heathens get the message while God's people don't. Could it be today that people that you and I would look at, ooh, they're getting it more than we are? Could it be that? Yes, I believe that. That's why we need to be humble and recognize God's hand on people's lives and expect God to move in ways you would never expect, people you would never expect. God wants to work through, but he wants to bring them to salvation. And so what happened is the wise men from the east came to Jerusalem saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews?" I mean, they study, they're looking, they're knowing, they heard something about what happened. Could it be that Daniel's prophecies when he was in Babylon, the Persian Empire, could it be that some of those things are floating around society still from Daniel's life, and now these Magi are reading and studying and heard about prophecies? I believe so, because Daniel actually prophesies when Christ will come to the year and time. It's amazing. So they were studying the Scriptures, apparently. So wise men from the east, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." Some astrologers believe that when Jupiter and Mars, there was a aligning of planets that happened. They think that could be a supernatural thing. I'm not quite sure. I think God often uses natural things supernaturally. And so this is a side note, but some people believe that when these planets lined up, it would put Jesus being born about April or May. So I hate to shatter. Can I tell you, I'm going to shatter Christmas for you. I'm sorry. Do you realize, you know why we celebrate on Christmas? And because they were pagan, people would celebrate the solstice and the shortest day of the year. And so the church made Christmas, this time of year, a time to remember Jesus, to counteract the paganism going on. So really, we should have Christmas in the spring more than likely. Okay, I just ruined it for everybody. I'm so sorry. But anyhow, that's what happened. Truthfully. But anyhow, let's move forward. "Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men to determine from them what time the star appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go and search,'" very, very shrewd here, Go and search carefully for your young child. And when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also. You see, Herod had one thing in mind, self-preservation. Herod had one thing in mind, I want to grab. I don't want to be generous. I want to keep what I have. I don't want to lose my power. I don't want anyone coming. I don't care if it's from God or not. I'm going to short-circuit someone taking away my lineage and my family line. And he lied in the guise, in the robes of worship. He was fooling them. So that I may come and worship. So we have two people, two sets of people, if you will, two mindsets. You have a Herod mindset, and you have the wise men mindset. When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. Jesus now was a toddler, probably about 2 years old. I know, I'm sorry, I'm ruining it for everybody. I apologize, okay? Before them, it came and stood over where the young child was, and when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy because they knew that the prophecies had been fulfilled. I don't know how much they knew at this point, but they knew God. Listen, God is all around the world trying to reach people, and he'll use extraordinary means through visions and dreams, but often he uses you and I and missionaries to reach them. That's why we have to do everything we can to reach people. There are people out there that are hungry, that are waiting to hear the news, and God chooses to utilize us. And so when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child Mary with his mother and fell down and worshiped him. They went down. What do? They humbled themselves. This is a baby. This I'm not a baby, but a toddler. They humbled themselves, fell down and worshiped him. And when they have opened their treasures, they brought a gift. They put wheels on their generosity. They opened their treasures. They presented to him gold, which represents kingship. Frankincense was the thing used in the temple for the holy place. The tabernacle would burn frankincense. So the gold represent the kingdom, kingship. Frankincense represented the temple and how you ought to worship God. And you know what myrrh was? Burial spices. This is what you would use for a dead body. So isn't it amazing that prophetically God spoke? I don't think the wise men had any idea what they're doing. But God utilized them. Sometimes we think the world's out of control. No, it's not. God understands what's going on. It's not out of control. It's not a driverless car. It's not like someone had a heart attack and they floored the vehicle and it's going on. No, God knows what's going on. He has his hand on the wheel of history. And so these guys had no idea. So you have the gold, kingship, frankincense, worship, and then you have myrrh, which signifies that he was going to die. And by the way, all this was extraordinarily a lot of money. And as a result of this, Mary and Joseph were able to go to Egypt and live for a long period of time. When Herod, and what happened? So you have the wise men that were bowing before Jesus Christ, the wise men that worship, and then you had the what? You had Herod, who would be the antithesis of that, or be like the opposite, would be the enemy. And what did Herod do? Then being divinely warned in a dream, this is the wise men, that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. We jump a couple of verses up. Then when he saw that he was deceived, he was exceedingly angry. Now what did he say? That I may come and worship him. But the moment he lost what he was trying to extract, something inside of him exploded. Let me ask you a question. When someone extracts something out of you, self-respect, or whatever it is, do you explode inside? Do you go into a rage? Now, you may not be enraged outwardly, but inside, something explodes. Could it be that selfishness is being touched? When you're in an argument or a disagreement with your spouse or children or coworker or boss or whatever, and something blows up inside of you, usually there's a reason why something blows up. There's something usually wrong, and it usually starts with the S. It's called selfishness. The greatest problem when you and I have as far as sin is selfishness. And what happened to Herod? He was selfish. It made him mad. He was so crazy that he figured out the time when Jesus would have been born that he decided to wipe out boys 2 years and younger. A great slaughter took place. This is what selfishness can do. So you have a contrast between generosity and selfishness. Both of them saying they want to worship. The fruit tells where they really are. What's the fruit in your life about generosity? Is there a wake of blessing behind you or a wake of trouble? Is there a wake of broken relationships? Is there a wake of difficulty? Is there a wake of stress and anxiety? Or is there a wake of peace, tranquility, and blessing? I don't know about you, but I want to have a wake of peace, love, and tranquility. Because when you are generous, there's no strings attached. You drop it off and you let it go. There's no leash on generosity. You release the animal, if you will, and it goes. You don't bring it to the altar with a leash on there until the priest tries to, no, take it this way. We try to control. But you release it unto God. And that's what we need to be able to do. So what happened? He was exceedingly angry. He put to death the male children. Horrible, horrible set of circumstances. And so you can see what happened. The contrast between the wise men and Herod. My question to you this morning is, where are you this morning, this Christmas season? Are you more like the wise men? Or you're more like Herod. And so as we look forward in this, the enemy of generosity is selfishness. It is an enemy. It is an enemy. It fights against everything you and I try to do. So clearly demonstrated and written in the book of James, what starts quarrels and wars is not your desire to have. You have not, so you go after. But if you would ask God, he would give to you. In other words, you're trying to get something without God, and you and I are made to receive to God and give to God. Anytime you take something that's not from God and try to take God out of the equation, you're going to be unbalanced. You talk about a chemical imbalance? The whole world is on a chemical imbalance. And the way we balance ourselves is become generous. Generosity will heal a lot of depression, anxiety, worry, will heal poverty, will heal relationships. And you know the beautiful thing is? It's free. Anyone can be generous. What a beautiful thing. And you'll find that the greatest people I know are the most generous people that I know. Some of the wealthiest people, I know some people that are extremely wealthy. I know someone that's a multi-millionaire. And I didn't want to mention her name because they would not like it. I just met them recently. Kevin and I had an opportunity to go to New York City. We met a billionaire. And I tell you, you would never know he's a billionaire. He was the most laid-back guy. He came up to us and talked to us. Who are we? You know, we're just there. He starts talking to us. I had no idea who he was. So I said, hey, where are you guys from and all that. He walks away and my friend goes, you know who that is? I said, I had no idea. So that person owns this company and they're worth $4 or $5 billion. Guy was so generous, so gracious. He was not trying to parade himself. He truly is a man of God. Amazing. And then he got up and spoke, and he talked about what's going on. He did it so humbly. It was beautiful. I never met a billionaire before, but he was a godly man. And the heritage of him and what he's doing, it is amazing. And the humility that was there. You see, the enemy of generosity is selfishness. If God can't trust you what's small, he will not entrust you what's great. And so now I wanted to bring another story which will contrast between generosity and selfishness. And here's another one. 6 days before the Passover now. We're running way ahead now. Jesus is now towards the end of his life. He's 33 years old. And about 2 months ago, he raised Lazarus from the dead. Now 2 months have transpired. And now Jesus is getting ready for the Passover, for the end of his life. And 6 days before the Passover celebration began, Jesus arrived in Bethany, which is about 5 miles from Jerusalem. The home of Lazarus, the man he had raised from the dead, a dinner was prepared in Jesus' honor. What a great thing, right? In Jesus' honor. So why? The dinner was for Jesus' honor. That was all about. Martha served And Lazarus was among those who ate with him. So let me just help you understand, to remind you what's happening. What is this dinner about? It's to who? To honor who? Honor Jesus. Exactly. It was about honoring Jesus. It was about worshiping him. Now, you're going to see something here very interesting. Then Mary, that's Lazarus' sister, remember he had Mary and Martha. Martha was always busy. Mary served the feet of Jesus. Okay, here's Mary again. Then Mary took a 12-ounce jar of expensive perfume made from the essence of nard. It was like essential oils, I guess. That's for the people that sell that. Okay. And she anointed Jesus' feet with it, wiping his feet with her hair. You normally would put it on someone's forehead, but what does she do? She took 12 ounces of the stuff. It was in a very precious jar, and she broke it, it says in the parallel passage, and she anointed not his head, but his feet, and used her hair. It's extraordinary. It was like out of the park, generous, to the point it made people feel extremely uncomfortable. The house was filled with fragrance, but anytime you see a but in scripture, you know there's a problem. But, and so when you're talking to somebody, little bit of advice. When you say, you know, honey, I think the dinner was great, don't say but. As soon as you say but, it destroys, it basically wipes out, it annihilates what you just said. You know, I think you're real nice, but. Say, honey, the dinner was fantastic, and the rolls were a little burned because I didn't take them out of the oven. It was my fault. Okay? That's how you do it. All right. Anyhow. But Judas Iscariot, the disciple who would soon betray him, said, okay, this is going to sound real religious and real pious. That perfume was worth a year's wages. Now, what's a year's wages? It depends on the economy. Let's just suppose in America today, I think the average income is about $55,000. Last time I checked, or whatever you make, imagine taking your year's salary and pouring it at someone's feet. It seems absolutely insane, ridiculous. How could this woman do this? The reason why this woman did it, because the women get it before the men get it. You know, it's so interesting. I don't know how. I don't know if anyone else experiences this, but I can't find stuff. I just can't. Honey, go get the paper towel. Okay, I look. I can't find them. Sandra comes in. I mean, it's amazing, right? And I thought it was just me. I thought there was something wrong with me. So I went to the eye doctor, and I got progressives. I still can't find stuff. And then I talked to my other friends and said, no, my wife finds everything. So I really believe that women should be investigative reporters. They should be archaeologists because they can find everything. Even in the office, I'm like, where is it? I'm asking Janine and Cynthia. Oh, it's over here. I was like, I don't understand. Anyhow, women get it, guys don't. I don't know what it is. But nevertheless, that's my little beef. That perfume was worth a year's wages. 100 grand, 50 grand thrown at the feet of Jesus, poured out. Look at here. This sounds real pious and real religious. It should have been sold and given money to the poor. What a waste. How could you guys build a church and have a coffee shop when there's people in Africa that meet under a tree? What a waste. I said, well, I had one time a pastor friend of mine told a story about a friend of his, and they were driving through their neighborhood, and this pastor, he pastors a pretty large church, and he's going through there. This guy with another pastor said, look at that house. He goes, yeah, that's one of the guys of our church. He's very, very generous and a wonderful person. Oh, pff, sure he is. And he said he wanted to minister to him, so he ministered to him. He said, well, why don't you sell your house and give it away? The guy was saying, well, he should sell his house and give it to the poor. Why don't you sell your house and give it to the poor? You see, when someone says that, usually there's a problem. Usually, I've never heard anyone said it should be having sold and given to the poor. I've never heard a generous person say that. Anyone says that statement, usually they have a Judas spirit. I can't believe what extravagance there you. It's a waste. It could have been given to the poor. And you should say, wait, okay, why don't you sell your car and give it to the poor? Well, I can't do that. It's only a Honda Accord. So you know what? Be careful when you begin to criticize someone else's worship. When you have that attitude, usually it's because someone did something greater than you and you're jealous. You know, it's funny. They live in this neighborhood. It's like, oh, I can't. Someone's always extravagant if they have more than you. But if you go to the next level, do you believe this, that people look at you and think you're extravagant? No, they don't. Yes, they do. Because someone makes less money than you. Some people are saying, if I could only make X amount of dollars, then I would be. And then looking at you, and you're saying, if you're making $25,000, you're saying, if I could only make 50, like those rich people, and then by God's grace, you somehow make 50. And you're thinking, if I can make 100, and someone makes 100, if I can make 200. We've had a conversation with people that said, you know, I don't know how anyone can survive without making $500,000 a year. I'm like, huh? Well, try me. So what happens is the person that makes $500,000 a year says, I don't know anyone can make it without making $1 million a year. And it goes on and on and on. The person that is outlandish and crazy is the person that makes more than you. So here the perfume would have worth years. It should have been sold and the money given to the poor. Now listen to this. Why would Mary give such an extravagant gift? I mean, can I be truthful with you this morning? Which I try to be. I think I would have said something too. I would have been like, what is she doing? I would have said it quietly to somebody else. But I wouldn't have been bold as Judas. But why would Mary give such an extravagant gift? And why would Judas get upset? I think we just shared the reason why. Because he was being shown up. The Spirit of God was released in this gift. It was an amazing thing that happened. That perfume was years away. It should have been sold to the poor. And then he says, no, here we go. Now we found out the truth about it. It wasn't he cared. No, no. Not that he cared for the poor. No, no. He was a thief. And since he was in charge of the disciples' money, he often stole some for himself. Now, let me ask you a couple of questions. Do you think Jesus would know that was going to happen? Yes, because Jesus said about 2 years earlier, one of you is a thief. He said that out loud. So he said about one of you is going to betray me. He said that a couple of years earlier. Do you think Jesus knew that Judas was going to do what he's going to do? Yes, he knew. Then why did Jesus give Judas the money box? Was he trying to get him to fail? No, I don't believe that. I think he was trying to give him an opportunity. Even though he knew the outcome, he gives us an opportunity. Even though God knows our weakness, he gives us an opportunity. What happens when we have that opportunity? What did it have? He stole. He was a thief. You know what it says in Malachi? It says, you have stolen from me. How have we stolen you? With your tithes and offerings. I don't check what people give. I make it my business not to make it my business. But let me tell you something. The Bible is very clear about this. The tithe is mine. In fact, New Testament, it's all his. It's all his. So are we a thief? Are we taking what's God's? Are we taking what's God's? I believe this very strongly because I've seen it in my own personal life. I've seen it in the lives of others. The people that have the most, I've never seen a healthy relationship with people that was stingy with God. And since he was in charge of the money box for himself, Jesus replied, he said, leave her alone. She did this in preparation for my burial. Do you realize that Jesus, because he was on the cross, because it was sundown, they could not properly anoint his body for death. He was not anointed. But do you realize what Mary did? She anointed Jesus for his death. On the first day of the week, the women came with a huge amount of spices to anoint the body of Christ, and Christ was gone already. He was risen from the dead. So leave her alone. She did this in preparation for my burial. I don't even know she understood what she was doing, but the Spirit of God in her did. You see the difference between a Judas and a Mary? Which one do you want to be? And so the extravagance of generosity. God is an extravagant God. He didn't just give us things. He gave himself. How extravagant can you get that you give your only begotten son? How extravagant can you get where you leave everything you have and go down to our level? Philippians chapter 2 is an amazing chapter that everyone should read. Although being God did not equate equality with God, something to be grasped, but emptied himself and became that of a bond servant. So this is what we did. The extravagance of generosity. God is extravagant. When you and I are extravagant, We become like God. It's all about giving. Real giving is living. But God demonstrated his own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ, what? Died for us. He is extravagant towards us. I want to show you another story now. We talked first about the wise men. We talked about Jesus with Mary and the anointing of the feet. And now we're talking about something else. Another extravagant gift given from a person none of us would have noticed. Jesus, a couple of years earlier, was sitting in the temple with the court of the Gentiles, and where they have the money, where they have these little boxes where people would give money. And Jesus sat the opposite. This is found in Mark, the treasury, and watched the people putting money into the offering box. I believe God does that today too. He watches us. How are they gonna steward? I hope it's like my children. When I watch my kids, I want to see if they're gonna be generous to each other. Are they gonna do it? And we give them opportunities. I hope they learn. And I tell you, it's a great, great thing when I see generosity expressed through our own children. It makes a parent happy. Is it not true? Well, it makes God happy. And Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the people putting money into the offering box. Many rich people put in large sums. Now, if you and I were watching, like, look at that person. I'm going to put them in leadership. I'm going to put her in leadership. Wow. I'm going to give them a fast track because they have a lot of money. That's what you would think normally. They're a major donor. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with people that are major donors, but there's a problem with people that look at people that way. Do you follow me? So, many rich people put in large sums, and a poor widow came and put two small copper coins, which make a penny. So, you and I would have thought nothing of it, like whatever, you know. If you're sitting there and you're watching, you know, keep an eye on the money box. I will, priest. The guy's sitting there watching this, okay. Pay attention to the people that drop the big coins because we want to get them, you know, we want to get them on the fast track to leadership. We want to take them out to lunch. We want to get them on the planning committees because, you know. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with making money. Making money is fine. Money is immaterial. It is a neutral. It's neutral. It's what you do with it. The love of money is the root of it. Not money. The love of money. And so I'm sure they were watching those people. Many rich people put a large sum, and a poor widow came and put two small copper coins, which makes a penny. You know what Jesus said? And he calls his disciples to him and said, truly, I say to you. Now listen, this woman was showing generosity. It was a public display of generosity. Aren't you glad we don't have the buckets up here front? Anyhow, and he called his disciples to him and said to them, truly, I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all of those who are contributing to the offering box. For they all contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put everything she had. She has had to live on. This was an extraordinary, extravagant, wasteful, in our understanding, thing. But what did God do? He blessed her. And now we're talking about this widow 2,000 years later. You see, there's three levels of giving. It's in the Bible. First is tithes and offerings. Okay? And often what we talk about, Malachi, bring the tithe. Tithe equals 10%. Okay, that's what the Bible says is mine. Even Jesus said that you should tithe. It's even talked about in Hebrews. So we go to the next section here. Offerings. This is above your tithe. This is when you give beyond that. You can bring tithe, goes to the local house, right? Offerings go to missionaries or different things of that nature. Then you have the third gift. It's extravagant giving. This is when you're like, unbelievable. You're doing things that are extraordinary. I can tell you right now, you'll never get to two or three until you get to here. You know what's so beautiful is I'm not controlled by money anymore. I'm not. Ever since I was a little boy, I was taught, give me a dollar, I put 10 cents in. I just what I would do. I learned it, and our family learned it. We were never in want. We were greedy at times. I've been greedy. I want something, but I've never been in want. And you know what I do? God, I'm trusting you. I'm believing in you, Father. I've tithed. I'll give my offerings. Thank you. Just the other day, I was praying in the woods, and we were trying to go away, and we could not find anything. And so I just prayed. I said, Lord Jesus, now this sounds a little bit trite, but it's important. I said, Lord Jesus, I pray. I was having a good time with the Lord. I said, Lord Jesus, I pray right now that you would open up a thing that we would find a nice place to stay in Jesus' name. I claim it in Jesus' name. At the same time, my daughter and my wife were looking at the computer, and they found something. And my daughter says, Dad just prayed for this. I sense it. I get home that evening. And my wife said, were you praying at this time? I said, yep, that's when we found it. God cares. So I can go to God, say, God, you know, and listen, God made a way for this building. He did. He makes a way. So I don't worry about money. It doesn't mean you're stupid with money. It doesn't mean you are wasteful with money. But you know what? God, I don't worship money. I worship God. Money. I mean, tomorrow the stock market could crash. Well, Monday it will. Well, hopefully it won't. You know, we could have an international conflict and all the money means nothing. Who cares? At the end of your life, you're not going to be saying, oh, my bank account. You're going to be thinking, oh, who I loved. Even the people that you love, the people you love, and the God you serve, you're not going to be thinking about things. Oh, I wish I had a better vacation home. I wish I drove a better car. I wish I had a bigger house. You're not going to care about those things. You're going to care about two things, three things. Your life, the ones you love, and God. That's it. Why waste your life on anything else? And so listen, guys, listen, I'm going to let you know here. This is the way to live. And my wife and I, we've lived on here, and we've done some of this at times as well. Painfully done it. It's been painful. No, God told us, listen, we don't do it under manipulation. If we pray about it, some of you need to pray with your spouse. And sometimes when we gave to this building project, it was sacrificial for us. And so I prayed, my wife prayed. Guess what? We had the same number, independently of each other. We knew the Lord told us to give a certain amount of money. And what a blessing. God met every single need we had. He just did. And so I'm telling you, the three levels of giving, you cannot outgive God. You cannot outgive God. However, you can outgreed God. Let me say that again. You can't outgive God, but you can outgreed God. If you're greedy, that will happen because God's not greedy. Being generous has absolutely nothing to do with your bank account, but everything to do with your heart account. You might want to write that one down. Being generous has absolutely nothing to do with your bank account, but everything to do with your heart account. When you realize it's His, it's a beautiful thing. God, help me with this. Lord, you said I could do this. God, I need the money. God, you said, you tell me, God, you told me. And I don't say it in a bad way. I don't like threaten God. I just say, God, listen, this is yours. You put me in charge of this, God. This is your family you put in charge. This is your church, God. So help me out, God. You know what? And He does. Being generous has nothing to do with your bank account, but everything to do with your heart account. And what's the reward of generosity? There is a reward. There's a reward this side of heaven and the other side of heaven. You know what happened here? It happened was the woman with the Mary, okay? This is what Jesus said about Mary, the one that anointed His feet. But she has done what she could. She has come beforehand to anoint my body for burial. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her. This morning, we're talking about Mary. God, Jesus, exalts woman, doesn't He? Isn't it amazing? We're talking about what this woman did. Extravagant, wasteful. It says in Luke 16, if you're faithful in little things, you'll be faithful in large. If you're faithful with a little bit of money that God gives you, He'll give you more. But if you're dishonest in the little things, you won't be honest with greater responsibilities. And if you're untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches of heaven? Listen, we're going to do something this morning a little bit different. I'm going to ask you guys to give me a pack too. Can I have one of those things? We want to do a little exercise here this morning because you know what? You guys are a generous church. I want to let you know that. We were able to give over $3,200 to the homeless to help out the homeless shelter in town. You guys give hundreds of thousands of dollars away in missions over the last several years. You've been generous towards this church. You're a generous church. But you know what I really want to encourage us to do? I'm going to ask you to hand out to one adults, please. And let me explain what's going to happen here. We have a blessing bag starter kit, okay? And what this thing talks about here, if you open it up, I'm going to ask you, do not spend it on yourself. and do not spend it on people that you necessarily know in your own family or in your church. It says here, God has blessed us to be a blessing. What we want to demonstrate, we want to demonstrate the love, care, and generosity of God to others. Pray and ask God who you can bless with the unchurched or non-believers. And so in the back it says, please use the enclosed cards to invite someone to our Christmas Eve service. Invite someone to church. You can make this a habit by keeping a blessing bag with you. Bless it forward. It's more blessed to give than to receive. And we're entrusting you with $5. All right? Oh, big deal. Well, we're doing to the whole church. And what we want to do is we want to be able to bless people. Does it have to be the poor? Listen, let me tell you something right now. The homeless, normally you don't give money to the homeless. I'm just letting you know. You buy them something, but you do not give them normally money because it's not a good idea. I'm talking about anyone at the office. Maybe you're at Starbucks, and then maybe there's someone at the checkout line at Walmart, and you can tell the person is struggling. Well, maybe, how about you add $20 to this and just say, you know, I just want to let you know that Jesus loves you, and I just want to wish you a Merry Christmas, and hand them a $25 bill. You know what that will do? That will bless that person. And this is what? Let me make a couple rules. Number one, don't spend on people that you know or in this church. Number two, pray and ask the Holy Spirit who you should give it to. And also ask the Holy Spirit how much more you should put in it. This is a starter pack. One time I went to a restaurant. I'm just telling you as an example. And I could tell the waitress was having a hard time, real hard time. The bill was like $20. I left $60 tip. Just to bless her, and I left a little thing, Lord bless you, and I prayed for her, and we left the $60 tip. I walked out of there, and I felt so good. I know it sounds selfish, but it's not selfish, because when you're generous, it's a blessing. So we want to encourage you. Did everyone get one of these already? Okay. So would you do that today? Would you do that, folks? Would you do that this next week? Would you pray? As a matter of fact, let's just lift these bags in the air right now. Let's pray right now. I entrust you guys. Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, you so loved the world that you gave. Father, I thank you for a Cornerstone Church being a generous church. I just pray, Father, Holy Spirit, that you lead every single person to show them what they should give, how much they should increase it, and how they can be a blessing to somebody else. In Jesus' name, amen. Do me a favor. When you get something, would you please put in your connection cards stories of what has happened? I'm believing God for 400 or 500 different stories about what God has done by us being generous to other people. And by the way, a good thing to also do is to make another bag for yourself and put maybe some stuff on here, hand warmers or something like that. And when you see a homeless person that will work for food, you can open it up and give them a bag or something. Listen, it's time to be generous. Christmas is all about giving. And the Bible says this. I'm going to ask the worship team to make their way back, please. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. But to all who believed, maybe some of you believe in Jesus. You believe in Jesus. Yeah, I believe in Jesus. I know he was a historical figure. I even believe he died on the cross. Have you accepted him? You know what the beautiful thing is? You don't have to get your act together first. All you have to do is surrender. I don't care how bad you are, what you've been through. Say, God, this is what God loves you just the way you are, but he loves you way too much to keep in that direction. He wants to see you grow. So all who believed in him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. So I don't know where you are. Let's just bow our heads here this morning. And I want to pray right now. I don't know where you are this Christmas season, but I want to encourage you to accept the greatest gift you could ever accept. It's such a generous gift. It's a gift that you enjoy both now and forevermore. It's a gift that is greater than any bank account, any 401k, any better than any stock or bond, better than any savings account, better than any home. It's called Jesus. And so, Father, in Jesus' name, go ahead and you pray quietly in your own heart. Lord Jesus, I realize that you are God. I thank you for coming to the earth and dying on the cross to pay for the sins that I committed. Not only do I believe in you, but I receive your forgiveness. I ask you to forgive me right now of all of my sins, both known and unknown. And with all the grace I have, I will walk with you for the rest of my life. Fill me with your strength in Jesus' name. With just every head bowed, you'd say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer for the first time or made a recommitment. Just see a quick show of hands. I know how to better pray for you guys. Thank you. Anyone else this morning? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The three or four of you this morning. Praise the Lord. If you can look up at me real quick. In your worship guide, if you don't have a worship guide, in your seat pocket in front of you, there's a little connection card here. It's called a connection card. It says right in the front area, it says, I am committing myself to Christ, or I'm renewing myself to Christ. Could you fill that out? And you could put it in the offering basket or give it to one of the people at the end of the service. We want to contact you. We want to help you grow. Listen, we're all in this together. God has awesome, awesome plans for you. Hope, a hope, and a future. He wants to bless you so much. And let today be your best Christmas. For those who are watching online, you can also click on the connection card online, and you can also do the same. So what we're going to do right now, I want to give an opportunity to give back to the Lord. Okay, let's just pray for the offering. Father, we want to thank you for today that, Lord, we can give back to what you've given to us. Lord, your life is not your own. Glorify God in your body. And so, Father, we return the tithes and we give the offerings this morning. I pray you bless every single need. Lord, we trust you and we believe you in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Let's go ahead and do that. We're going to put those cards in there. And as we're doing that, I'm going to say a couple other things. Coming up, we have Christmas Eve on Saturday evening at 4 o'clock and 5:30. It's only an hour service. And so people will come to church with you for weddings and funerals. And they'll come to Christmas Eve, and they'll come to Easter. Why not invite somebody? Inside of your packet is an invite card. As you walk out of here today, in a little, this little table, a little kiosk, you can take some cards and invite people. And we'll put some on Facebook as well. We can invite folks to come. They're going to hear the real meaning of Christmas. And have an opportunity to give their lives to God. We always give an opportunity for people to recommit their lives to Christ. Because all of us have fallen short of what God would have for us. So I want to encourage you with that. Okay, everybody? That's what's going on this coming. And then Saturday and Sunday morning at 10, one big service at 10 o'clock on Christmas Day. So it's 4, 5:30 next Saturday and Sunday morning at 10. If we could all stand. Let's all sing together here. I'm going to ask the prayer team to make their way up. And we're going to dismiss you right after the song. And you may leave if you'd like. We're going to open and ask the prayer team to make their way up. We want to pray for you, whatever you need. We want to stand in agreement with you. Let's sing. Come on.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May His face shine upon you, give you peace during this Christmas season. In Jesus' name, we're going to leave the front open. Listen, we want to invite you back to Grove Track today. Step 4 is how to get involved. You're a cornerstone. We have a lunch for you in childcare. Love to have you come back 12:30. Otherwise, we dismiss you. The front's open for prayer. God bless you.